Having completed node voltage analysis, we move on to another comprehensive technique. Well, sort of. Mesh currents analysis, though often preferred by students, is not really a comprehensive technique. That's because it only works in two dimensions, so it won't work on complex circuits. However, usually when we're first learning about circuits, we're not dealing with complex circuits, so it works pretty well in school. That doesn't mean it doesn't have practical applications, as not all useful circuits are complex. In addition, there are also times where we might apply it to a portion of a circuit, so there are practical applications for this analysis technique. Node voltage analysis was based upon Kirchhoff's current law, and we express the currents as voltages divided by resistance. In mesh current analysis, we're using Kirchhoff's voltage law, expressing the voltages in terms of currents. What is a mesh current? Well, if we have a simple circuit like this one, the current through the top left resistor we might call I1. If we call the current through the top right resistor I2, then by Kirchhoff's current law, at the middle node, we can define the current through the middle branch without introducing a new variable. It would be true that the current through the middle branch would be the difference between I1 and I2. How we describe this in terms of mesh currents is by defining I1 as the current through the left-hand loop, then the current through the right-hand loop is I2. Then in terms of loop or mesh currents, could also write the current in the middle branch as I1 minus I2. Let's apply mesh current analysis to a simple circuit consisting of a single voltage source and two loops. To give us a target for our analysis, let's say we're trying to determine the current through the 5 kilo ohm resistor. With mesh current analysis, we'll begin by identifying loops. I'll write them in terms of mesh currents, so we have I1 and I2. The next thing I'm going to do is choose a polarity for all the voltages. If possible, I will try to choose them so that they already agree with the passive sign convention with respect to the defined mesh currents. I will then do Kirchhoff's voltage law, starting with the left-hand loop. My habit is to start at the lower left-hand corner of a loop and go around clockwise. You can choose a different place to start if that works for you, as long as you begin and end in the same spot and go around in the direction of the current for the loop you're in. Starting in the lower left-hand corner, going around clockwise, the voltage supply is 15 volts. So the voltage increases by 15 volts, and it will be a positive voltage in the KVL equation. Continuing around the loop, as we pass through the 10 kilo ohm resistor, we go from a positive to a negative voltage as indicated by the voltage polarity. In addition, the direction of I1 and the indicated voltage agree with the passive sign convention, so that will be a voltage drop of minus 10 kilo ohms times I1. Next, we encounter the 5 kilo ohm resistor. Here we have two mesh currents interacting, so we have to pay a little more attention. The direction of the unknown current I and the polarity of the voltage indicated agree with the passive sign convention. That means the positive current is the one that agrees with I, so I1 is positive. I2 goes in the opposite direction, so that will be a negative current. As we cross the 5 kilo ohm resistor, we go from a positive to a negative, so that will be a voltage drop, and our term will be minus 5 kilo ohms times the quantity I1 minus I2. Being back at the node we started at, we have completed the loop, so this must add to zero. Onto the second loop. Again, starting in the lower left-hand corner and going around the loop in the direction of I2, we have a voltage rise across the 5 kilo ohm resistor. The current that agrees with the passive sign convention remains unchanged, so the term is 5 kilo ohms times the quantity I1 minus I2. Now we have the current through the 4 kilo ohm resistor. The current through it is just I2. The voltage polarity agrees with I2, so the term is minus 4 kilo ohms times I2. The same holds true for the 16 kilo ohm resistor. So we have a voltage drop of 16 kilo ohms times I2. That completes the second loop, so the voltages must add to zero. We now have the equations which describe the circuit. These can be simplified by taking the first equation and writing 15 volts equals 15 kilo ohms I1 minus 5 kilo ohms I2. The second equation can be simplified to 0 volts equals 5 kilo ohms I1 minus 25 kilo ohms I2. This equation simplifies to I1 equals 5 times I2. We can substitute this equation into the first, and 15 volts equals 15 kilo ohms times 5 I2 minus 5 kilo ohms times I2. This reduces to 15 volts equals 70 kilo ohms I2. This is equal to 15 volts divided by 70 kilo ohms, so I2 equals 0.21 milliamps. Then I1 is 5 times I2, so I1 is 1.05 milliamps. The current we're looking for was I. Referring back to the circuit, I is equal to I1 minus I2, resulting in a current of 0.84 milliamps. There's our introduction to mesh current analysis. The basic procedure is to define mesh currents and then write Kirchhoff's voltage law loops until we've covered the entire circuit. In that circuit, we had only voltages to deal with. The question of how to handle a current source still remains. This is also a simple circuit consisting of only two loops. However, in this circuit, the right-hand loop has a current source. For this circuit, say we're trying to determine the voltage Vx. I'll begin in the same way I began the last one. I'll define two mesh currents, I1 and I2. I will then indicate the polarity of voltages across the resistors that are not assigned voltages already. For loop 1 of this circuit, beginning in the lower left-hand corner, we see an increase of 20 volts. So that will be a positive 20 in the equation. Continuing on across the 12 kiloohm resistor, I will drop in voltage, so I'll have minus 12 kiloohms times the current through it. Current through it is just I1. Since the voltage Vx across the 8 kiloohm resistor goes from a positive to negative, it will be a drop of 8 kiloohms times I1 minus I2, because I1 agrees with the passive sign convention. We're back at the beginning, so that's a complete loop, and the voltages must add to zero. Looking at the second loop, we have a voltage indicated across the 8 kiloohm resistor. That will be the same voltage that's across the 1 milliamp current source. However, we do not have an equation that governs the voltage across a current source. This means we cannot write a Kirchhoff's voltage law equation that will help us find a solution. I do think in this case that we can easily deduce what I2 is going to be. I2 is the only mesh current that interacts with the 1 milliamp source. I2 goes in the opposite direction as the source. So for the second equation, we can write I2 equals negative 1 milliamp. Simplifying these two equations, I can write 20 volts equals 20 kiloohms times I1 minus 8 kiloohms times I2. And since I2 is negative 1 milliamp, I can substitute into the first equation and get that I1 is equal to 0.6 milliamps. Looking back at our circuit, we were looking for the value of Vx. Vx will be equal to the 8 kiloohm resistance times the current that agrees with the passive sign convention minus the current that opposes the passive sign convention. Substituting in our numbers, we have 8 kiloohms equals quantity 0.6 milliamps minus the negative 1 milliamps, which gives us a result of Vx is equal to 12.8 volts. We still have not covered all the difficulties we can encounter in mesh current analysis. At this point, I think there are two pieces missing. One, we have not done a dependent source. And two, we have not done a current source that touches more than one mesh current. So let's put these both into one glorious example. Here we have a circuit with a dependent current source that touches two loops. We can start the analysis with the same basic steps. First, I'll identify three mesh currents, I1, I2, and I3. Since we have a few mesh currents interacting, when I go through and indicate the voltages, I'll also draw the direction of the current associated with each of the voltages. With the four voltages indicated, I can then try to look at mesh 1. I notice that mesh 1 includes a current source, and since I don't have a relationship between the voltage and current of a source, I can not write a KVL loop around the first loop to solve the circuit. Kirchhoff's voltage law will still hold true, but I can't get any information that's going to help me solve the circuit. The second mesh current also touches the same source, so I cannot do a KVL loop that helps me solve the circuit around the second loop either. We can, however, look at mesh 1 and mesh 2 together and get two equations from them. First, from the current source, there are two mesh currents that touch it. I1 goes in the same direction as the current source, and I2 goes in the opposite direction. So I can say that the value of that current, which is 17 millisiemens times VA, is equal to I1 minus I2. While I cannot do a loop around one or two individually, I can go around the outside of the combination of them. This is still a closed path, and by Kirchhoff's voltage law, the voltage must add to zero. Beginning in the lower left-hand corner and going around clockwise, I have an increase of 20 volts. I then encounter the 1 kiloohm resistor, which will give me a voltage drop of 1 kiloohm times the current that agrees with the polarity of the voltage minus the current that does not. So we have 1 kiloohm times I1 minus I3. Next, we have a voltage drop across the 6 kiloohm resistor. That will be 6 kiloohms times I2 minus I3. Last, we have the voltage drop across the 4 kiloohm resistor, which is 4 kiloohms times I2. Let's take these two equations and set them up so that they're ready to go into a matrix. If we take the first equation and do the multiplication, we can gather the terms so that we have this. Then, separating the constants from the variables and adding a coefficient for every variable, we have this. The second equation simply requires reorganization. So right now we have two equations with four unknowns. Going back to the circuit, we can do a loop around the top mesh. Starting in the lower left-hand corner and going around clockwise, we have a voltage drop across a 15 kilo ohm resistor that is equal to 15 kilo ohms times I3. Continuing on the 6 kilo ohm resistor, we go from a negative to a positive. That will be a voltage increase. The current that agrees with the passive sign convention is I2, and I3 also touches the 6 kilo ohm resistor, so our term is 6 kilo ohms times I2 minus I3. The voltage across the 1 kilo ohm resistor is also an increase of the 1 kilo ohms times I1 minus I3. That completes the loop, so the total voltage must equal 0. Then, arranging this equation to make it matrix ready, we have this. Now we have three equations with four unknowns. The fourth equation will come from the controlling parameter of the dependent source. The controlling parameter is the voltage VA, that is the voltage across the 15 kilo ohm resistor. However, the polarity of VA differs from the polarity marked in red. To deal with that, we simply need to add a negative sign in front of the equation so that we have VA equals minus 15 kilo ohms times I3. This equation can then be rearranged so that it is ready to put into a matrix. So now we have four equations with four unknowns, each in terms of four variables. We can separate this into a matrix of coefficients times a column vector of variables equal to a column vector of constants. A system of equations arranged like this in the form of A times X equals B. The solutions can be found by applying the inverse matrix to each side of the equation. We then have a column vector of variables equals a column vector of solutions. The matrix calculation gives us this set of solutions. If we prefer, we can write the answer as follows. There we have it. We've covered the major situations you'll come across while doing mesh current analysis. Circuits may increase in size and the number of unknowns, but the basic procedure will remain unchanged. First, you're going to draw mesh currents in each of the independent loops. You'll define the polarity of voltages and currents according to the passive sign convention. If there are any current sources in the circuit, write the currents in terms of mesh currents. Then you're going to write KVL equations for the loops that do not have a current source. If there is a dependent source, write the controlling parameter in terms of mesh currents. Then solve the system of equations. That's all I have today. Thanks for watching. Go out and make it a great one.